अब मैं हमारी दूसरी पार्टी दूसरी प्रेजेंटर मिसेस तैयबा नाजली से गुजारिश करती हूं कि वो अपना पेपर पढ़ें।
मैं जैसा कि आप जानते हैं चैलेंजेस इन एजुकेशन के टॉपिक पर हम सब बात कर रहे हैं। मैं बात शुरू करने से पहले इस बात पर आपकी तवज्जो दिलाती हूं कि आजकल के आज के जो दो प्रेजेंटर्स रहे हैं प्रोफेसर पद्मावती और डॉक्टर मंजू शाह ने बहुत ही अहम तरीन मौजूद पर आप बात की। यूँ तो हम क्लास में यहाँ वहाँ बहुत सारी बार इन चीज़ों को दोहराते रहते हैं, लेकिन यहाँ पर मैडम ने बात की चैलेंजेस एक एस्पेक्ट पर बात की जिसमें उन्होंने टेक्नोलॉजी पर जोर दिया और चैलेंजेस जो चैलेंज लोग हैं उनको टेक्नोलॉजी किस तरह से मदद कर सकती है उस पर मैडम ने पद्मावती मैडम ने बात की। और डॉक्टर मंजू शाह ने बहुत ही खूबसूरत अंदाज में बहुत दिल की गहराइयों से उनके अंदाज में जो एक लजाजत थी एक उनके अंदाज में एक आप रिक्वेस्ट थी या अफसोस था वो साफ जाहिर था कि किस तरह हमारी एजुकेशन फेल हो रही है उन चीज़ों को हासिल करने में उन उमूर पर काबू पाने में जो हमारी सोसाइटी का हिस्सा बन गए हैं। हम इंसानियत को कहीं दूर अपने आप से कर चुके हैं और मटेरियलिज्म की तरफ भागे हुए हैं। अखलाक व किरदार की बुलंदी कोई ख्वाब की बातें हो गई हैं। तो मैं इसी नोट पर इसी मूड को बरकरार रखते हुए मैं आगे बढ़ना चाहती हूँ। मेरे दोहराने का मतलब सिर्फ यही था कि मैं बहुत अप्रिशिएट करती हूँ बहुत कदर करती हूँ इनके ख्यालात की कि कितना ज़रूरी है वैल्यू एजुकेशन हमारे अंदाज अतवार किरदार और ज़िंदगी में बहुत अहमियत रखती है। उसके बगैर मैं समझती हूँ एक टीचर बिल्कुल ही नामुकम्मल होता है अगर उसमें ये खसूसियात ना पाई जाती हों। तो मैं समझती हूँ मैंने शुरुआत तो थोड़ा सा आपसे उर्दू में बातचीत करके की लेकिन मेरा पेपर इंग्लिश में है और टेक्नोलॉजी के हिसाब से टेक्नोलॉजिकल जो इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी ने अपने पर फैलाए हुए हैं ज़िंदगी के हर फील्ड में जिससे एजुकेशन भी मुबर्रा नहीं है और ये किस तरह से हमको चैलेंजेस को फेस करने में टेक्नोलॉजी मदद करती है। यूँ तो आप देख ही रहे होंगे आप हर रोज़ उससे आपका मुशाहदा मुकाबला हो ही रहा होगा लेकिन फिर भी मैं इस पर रोशनी डालना चाहती हूँ कि किस तरह से तालीमी मैदान में टेक्नोलॉजी कितनी मददगार है और हम उससे कितना मुस्तफीद हो सकते हैं हो रहे हैं या हमको होना चाहिए। मेरा पेपर उसी बारे में है। उम्मीद करती हूँ कि आप पेशेंटली सुनेंगे और मैं मुख्तसर करने की कोशिश करूँगी उसको ज़्यादा तफसील में ना जाते हुए। सो माई टॉपिक इज़ मॉडर्न इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी एंड क्वालिटी इन हायर एजुकेशन। Quality of higher education lies in the effectiveness of transmitting knowledge and skill, the authenticity and depth of information, availability of teaching and learning material, the assistance in overcoming the problems in learning application of knowledge, and solving the problems of life. This is what I mean by quality in higher education. Information technology has progressed very fast in the last three decades. It has made equipment available at a cheaper price, making it feasible to people in general and teachers and students in particular. The technology has made it easy to search, disseminate, store, retrieve, transmit, receive the knowledge at a cheaper and faster mode. It is in everybody's knowledge that computers can be used to store, retrieve, process, transmit data and information at a great speed. Besides, computer hardware has become inexpensive and affordable for the institutions as well as for common man. Computer software for different applications also available nowadays. The objective of this paper is to highlight the possibilities of quality enhancement in college and university education by means of an intensive use of modern developments in information technology. मैं समझती हूँ आपने ये जान लिया होगा कि higher education में modern education technology किस हद तक मददगार हो सकती है टीचर स्टूडेंट की उस पर मैं बात करना चाहती हूँ और यही मेरा आज के पेपर पढ़ने का मकसद भी है। क्वालिटी इन हायर एजुकेशन से क्या मुराद है? एक्सेसिबिलिटी एंड क्वालिटी अपग्रेडेशन आर टू डायमेंशंस ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन विच मूव साइमल्टेनियसली। एक तो हम रसाई हो एक्सेसिबिलिटी मवाद तक रसाई हो और क्वालिटी भी हम साथ ही साथ इम्प्रूव कर सके ये दो मकासद हैं आज की तालीम के हायर एजुकेशन में आला तालीम के मकासद हैं। For India, being a country with a population of more than 1 billion, the quantitative expansion for education and accessibility is of extreme importance. The country also has to bridge the gap and disparities of region, gender, social stratification, etc. in the field of education. Along with the necessary quantitative expansion of higher education, it is also very important to improve the quality of higher education. Schools or colleges or universities ka number badhana hi zaruri nahi hai, balki usme maqsadiyat ko wazeh karna aur improve aur lekar chalna bhi nihayat ahem hai, uski quality aap jante hain. Mayari taleem bhi hamara maqsad hona chahiye, number of schools or colleges or universities ke saath saath. Educational opportunities that Indian universities have built up since independence have been able to produce graduates largely capable of pursuing limited careers. But now, in the new globally competitive scenario emerging in the country, the Indian student is required to develop a multi-talented personality to cope up with the very fast changes in the world. This demands the modern educational facilities in the institutions for higher education. Professional competence is a desirable necessity for meeting the challenges of the contemporary world. Brilliance is of no use if it's not put into practice. In order to achieve all these ends effectively, one has to see that the process of education are properly regulated in terms of the usage of technology. The rapid developments in science and technology and the challenges of globalization are posing additional challenges to the education system in the country. While the education system needs to keep pace with the scientific and technological advancements in terms of building the skills and knowledge, it should also has to address the fundamental issues of moral and social impact on the society due to usage of technology. So, aap jaan gaye honge ki yahan main kya kehna chahti hoon ki country bahut tezi se tarakki kar raha hai aur दुनिया के तेजी से बदलते हुए हालात में ग्लोबलाइजेशन के दौर में कंट्री को भी उसी रफ्तार से आगे बढ़ने की सख्त जरूरत है जिसमें टेक्नोलॉजी ही मदद करती है लेकिन इस बात का ख्याल जरूर रखा जाए कि उसके समाजी और अखलाकी असरात क्या हो रहे हैं यानी उसका यूज ठीक ढंग से ठीक मकसद के लिए हो रहा है या नहीं हो रहा है वो भी बहुत अहमियत रखती है बात जैसा कि आम चीज जो हम सुनते हैं वो इंटरनेट का इस्तेमाल है इंटरनेट का इस्तेमाल आप देखते हैं वो एक कैबिन्स में होता है लेकिन स्टूडेंट क्या सिर्फ तालीमी मकासद के लिए उसका इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं या फिर उसका सोशल इम्पैक्ट क्या समाज में सुधार हो रहा है उस वजह से या बिगाड़ पैदा हो रहा है ये भी आपको जानने की ज़रूरत है मकसद में हम कहीं फेल तो नहीं हो रहे हैं हम रीज़न कुछ और बताते हैं लेकिन नतायज सोसाइटी में जो हम देख रहे हैं वो जो सामने आ रहे हैं वो हमसे कुछ और कहते हैं तो हमको ये भी देखना है बहैसियत टीचर्स भी एजुकेटर्स भी कि सोसाइटी में हो क्या रहा है एक्चुअली और क्या मकसद में technology apne kamyab hai. It is crucial to identify the relative norms of different components of higher education system in 21st century. It's very essential and crucial to manage and maintain the teacher preparation to sustain quality in teacher input. Jitni behtar teachers hongi, utna hi output hoga students ki shakal mein. Like curriculum development and design, curriculum practice, evaluation of learners' performance and progress, and quality management. The quality of these components may differ from institution to institution. Therefore, sharing of the experiences among the institutions on the issues of quality will generate ideas for framing norms and strategies for their quality assurance. It is quite refreshing to note that various developments have been observed through the intervention of information and communication technology in education regarding quality assurance, such as networking of the open learning system with traditional universities, interdisciplinary interactions at intra-institutional, inter-institutional levels, networking the institutions at global level, database management of higher education, changing the orientation of institution, assessment and accreditation of higher education institution, and creation of regulatory bodies at national level. So, in an environment of global competitiveness, it is important that Indian products of the higher education institutions are as competent as graduates of any other country. Not only in their scholastic achievement, but also in terms of richness of their personality. Jis par abhi Dr. Manjusha baat kar rahi thi, richness of personality bhi utni hi ahem hai. तालीम के साथ साथ किरदार अगर बुलंद ना हो और मियारी ना हो तो तालीम अपनी अहमियत खो देती है Unless quality and standard of Indian higher education institutions is enhanced zealously and sustained at a high level through innovation, creativity and monitoring, it becomes very difficult for the Indian professionals to compete in present situation of globalization and privatization. The new challenge before the country at the beginning of the 21st century is to become a developed society by the year 2020, which requires a vibrant economy pushed by knowledge. The challenges in higher education are not only nation-centric, but have attained global dimensions. With the explosion of knowledge in the past century and with the development of tools of information and communication technologies as well as of other scientific innovations, competition has become a hallmark of growth all over the world. Therefore, India has to rise to the occasion and reorient its higher education system to be competitive, meaningful and purposeful. It is therefore essential for the country to meet the requirements of quality and the quantity in the future. The demands of the society for equity and accommodation cannot be neglected anymore. So, taleem ko aage aana chahiye, jahan par hum challenges ka muqabla kar sake. Ye chapter mera ye batata hai ki duniya challenge se bhari hui hai. Itna challenge duniya mein pehle kabhi nahi tha jitna aaj hai. To Hindustan students ko compete karne ke liye duniya ke dusre hisson se, duniya ke dusre students se, us level tak unko pahunchna hoga, kyunki aaj ki duniya sirf competition ki duniya ban kar rahi gayi hai. Pichle zamane mein aisa itna competition nahi tha. Yahan par competition se murad paisa kamane ke competition ki baat nahi kar rahi hu main. Baat hai aapki maharaton ki, aapki salahiyaton ka competition ki main baat kar rahi hu, jisme taleem apna role ada karti hai. Knowledge ki competition ki baat kar rahi hu. Kitna apni country aur home ko aap fayda pahuncha sakte hain, kahan kya ho raha hai, kitne khayalat, ideas, new inventions, creativity ne kitni tabdili lai hai, kin kin mulkon mein, kis university mein humne hum uplink kar sakte hain pure universities ko, qadeem universities ko, nayi universities se aur duniya ke dusre hisson mein paye jane wali universities ko, taleemi idaron ko, hamare taleemi idare se. Ye competition ki main baat kar rahi hu. Competition aap is sense mein le, quality improvement and enhancement ke liye competition ki main baat kar rahi hu. So, isko aap samjhe, the new regime under WTO, where competence only has become the principle of success in international operations. Aaj ke daur mein, World Trade Organization, jo bani hai, jisme har jagah sakht tarin competition hai. Yahan par, inhone ye declare kar diya hai, ke competition hi zindagi ka mayar aur maqsad hai. To, aise situation mein, Hindustani tulba kya kar rahe hain, kahan hain, kahan tak pahunche hain, unko kya karna chahiye. Ye aaj ka challenge hai hamare bilkhusus hamare tulba ke liye. So success in international operation made it clear that the country should exploit its excellent potential in higher education and training facilities and prepare itself to send the Indian brand of education to foreign countries. It is an opportunity which offers the possibilities making the nation's talent a resourceful, more strong and presentable. The impact next chapter jo main topic hai usko main short karte hue sirf aapko headings main bata dena chahti hu jaise ki madam ne kaha hai ki main isko short karu to aur kaun se awamil hain kaun se anasir hain jo quality enhancement mein madad karte hain main unke sirf titles aapko bata dun. The impact of modern information technology on the quality of higher education, kya asraat rahe hain modern information technology ke quality of education par. Aur era of ye daur hai e-text, e-books, ई डॉक्यूमेंटेशन का, जहाँ पर हर चीज़ इलेक्ट्रॉनिकली अवेलेबल है उसको, मगर इसका इस्तेमाल हमको कितना सही आता है, कहाँ तक हम पहुँचे हैं, क्या हम उसको इस सिचुएशन, इस सहूलतों से हम इस्तेफादा करने के काबिल हुए हैं, ये सवाल है. दूसरा है डेवलपमेंट ऑफ पोर्टेबल स्टोरेज, कम से कम चिप में, पेन ड्राइव में, कम से कम चीज़ों में आप उसको स्टोर कर सकते हैं. नेक्स्ट है जी, जी थैंक यू. Then development of internet and world wide web, ये भी आप सब जानते हैं कि internet है, आप सब जानते हैं कि world wide web है, सब है, लेकिन उसका फिर इस्तेमाल, उसका उससे इस्तेफादा, उन सहूलतों से वाकफियत, ये कितनी है, ये हम कर रहे हैं या कर पा रहे हैं, नहीं कर पा रहे हैं, और कर रहे हैं तो कहाँ तक, किस हद तक, क्या सिर्फ नोट्स जमा करने के लिए, क्या सिर्फ एग्ज़ाम पास करने के लिए, या फिर काहे के लिए, कहाँ तक. ये भी आपको जान लेना चाहिए. ये सहूलतें हैं, आप जानते हैं, इंटरनेट से बहुत कुछ डाउनलोड किया जा सकता है, इंटरनेट से बहुत कुछ स्टोर किया जा सकता है, इन्फॉर्मेशन को रिट्रीव किया जा सकता है, लेकिन उसका इस्तेमाल किन किन मकासद के लिए कहाँ तक किया जाना चाहिए, क्या हो रहा है, ये सवाल आपको स्टूडेंट्स को बिलखसूस, टीचर्स को भी, सिर्फ स्टूडेंट्स से ही मैं मुखातिब नहीं हूँ, सबको ये करना चाहिए, चाहे वो किसी भी इंस्टीट्यूशन से ताल्लुक़ रखते हों. ये एडवांसमेंट ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन, एक्सप्लोजन ऑफ नॉलेज है, तो एक्सप्लोजन ऑफ नॉलेज में से आपको इन्फॉर्मेशन को छान कर अपने लिए कहाँ तक फ़ायदेमंद बनाना है, ये हमारा मकसद है, होना चाहिए. देन डेवलपमेंट ऑफ ई लाइब्रेरी एंड इंसाइक्लोपीडिया वगैरह वगैरह. नाउ फैसिलिटीज़ जो इंस्टीट्यूशंस में अवेलेबल हैं और क्वालिटी के पैरामीटर्स क्या हैं, यानी क्वालिटीज़ को, क्वालिटी ऑफ एजुकेशन को नापने के आले क्या हैं, किन चीज़ों को हम जानकर ये कहेंगे कि ये क्वालिटी जांचने के लिए ये ज़रूरी है, उस पर यहाँ पर तफसील मैंने कुछ लिखी है. तो नेशनल एजुकेशन कमीशन ने भी बहुत वाज़े यहाँ पर रिकमेंडेशंस किए हैं कि टेक्नोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल किन किन लेवल पे कहाँ कहाँ कैसे किया जाए और किन मकासद के लिए किया जाए, इसका भी मैंने जिक्र किया है पेपर में. एंड मॉडर्न इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी एंड क्वालिटी इन हायर एजुकेशन, फिर तफसील है इसकी. देन पॉजिटिव इफ़ेक्ट्स ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी, इसके मुस्बित असरा सोसाइटी पर क्या हुए हैं वगैरह. मैं आखिर में कंक्लूड करना चाहती हूँ कि एज़ वी ऑल नो दैट द इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी हैज़ प्रोग्रेस वेरी फास्ट इन द लास्ट 3 decades. इट हैज़ प्रोड्यूस इक्विपमेंट्स एट अफोर्डेबल कॉस्ट एंड हैज़ मेड इट्स एप्लीकेशन वेरी फिजिबल. दिस टेक्नोलॉजी हैज़ मेड सर्च, गैदरिंग, स्टोरिंग, रिट्रीवल, ट्रांसमिशन, रिसेप्शन ऑफ नॉलेज नॉट ओनली ईजियर, फास्टर, बट ऑल्सो इनएक्सपेंसिव. द ई लाइब्रेरीज आर लाइब्रेरीज ऑफ टुमारो एंड द लाइब्रेरीज इन प्रिंट्स में बिकम एन एंटिक थिंग. An effective use of advancement in IT will and shall improve quality in higher education. So, quality in higher education needs effective governance. Information technology can be used to strengthen governance of higher education. Phir maine is par ye bhi aur tafseel kahi hai ki at present the institutions of higher learning in India do not use IT properly. Though it is increasing day by day, it is a fact that many institutions do not have World Wide Web. The potentials of websites for educational purpose are not fully utilized by such institutions. Digitization of libraries is also moving at a very slower pace since the institutions do not have sufficient infrastructure to make it possible. The institutions also lack in the program to sensitize teachers and students to use the modern methods of information. Hamari idaron ke paas aisa koi program nahi hai jahan par teachers ko aur students ko train kiya ja sake कि वो मॉडर्न टेक्नोलॉजी से भरपूर इस्तेफादा कर सकें. ये सबसे बड़ी खामी हमारे इंस्टीट्यूशंस में पाई जाती है जिसको दूर जितना जल्दी करें हिंदुस्तान दूसरी यूनिवर्सिटीज़ और दूसरे कंट्रीज से उतने ही बेहतर तौर पर मुकाबला कर पाएगा. सो दिस इज़ वन ऑफ द चैलेंज अगेन. देयरफॉर इट इज़ अ नीड दैट इंस्टीट्यूशंस ऑफ हायर लर्निंग ऑर्गेनाइज प्रोग्राम्स टू ट्रेन द टीचर्स द स्टूडेंट्स to harness the modern advanced information technology to enrich teaching and learning process which will help in improving the quality in education. The training program should include the possible application of computers, internet, world wide web, websites, educational portals, available e-libraries, e-based encyclopedia, etc. Education institutions should be web conscious as urgent. They should become web conscious as soon as possible because it is the need of the hour. Thank you.
Is session ki teesri paper presenter hain Ms. Laiq Unisa. She is from Riemann College of Education. She is a lecturer.
So today's my topic is challenges in higher education, issues and perspectives. As madam has said that I have to brief my topic. So for the progress of any country, it is the main important, most important thing that every country citizen should be educated. I mean in the sense that higher education. So the main emphasis on higher education is the progress of any country in education. So the main emphasis of the policy of education, national policy of education, that is 1986. Policy and also the policy of 1992 policy also has laid the most important stress on higher education, that is to educate, train and to determine the research and provide the services to the community. And also they have given the achievement to the to equalize the educational opportunities, especially for Indian women, scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and other communities. So here Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the late Prime Minister of India, also had started the Open University, that is the IGNO University, in 1985. And Indian higher education system is the largest system in the world. So with overall 14 million students, with a 500,000 teachers are challengers before this higher education. In the context, in the face of globalization, privatization, resource crunch, and also the enrollment ratio. The main objective of my paper is to highlight the current issues and perspectives. So let me know the challenges of this higher education. So the challenges of his higher education is financial crisis. The first and the most important part for any student to start his education is the financial crisis. So there is a great help from the government, from both the government. I can say that central government as well as state government and other local bodies, which is helping a great deal for the students nowadays, providing the fellowships in research and scholarships, and providing a great deal to the students. And in the challenges of higher education, the second and the most important point is the privatization. The privatization is the most important challenge. There is a difference, there is a variation in evaluation system. So, but practically I want to say that we have just moved and we are at where we were before the 50 years ago. Next is promotion of the inclusive education. Promotion of inclusive education should be encouraged more in India. Like as Madam has, Professor Padmavati Madam has laid a stress on guiding, counseling and also special needs and disadvantaged students. So special needs of children should be given more advantage, and with that, with their needs should be emphasized, and we have to give their needy education for these people. So next is self-financing colleges. There have been repeated statements made by various funding organizations that the educational institutions devoted to higher education should review their position with respect to the grants that they have been getting so far. So their financial dependence on the central and state government must be reduced to minimum level. So next is the pick, place and promote criteria. So there is a need to perfect the recruitment promotion criteria for the higher education in comprehensive and updated need-based facility should be provided for database management system. Resource mobilization. Resource mobilization is the present inadequate scenario and other institutions of higher learning. This should be taken up and measures should be given to solve this financing of higher education. Promotion of relevant education. The higher education will not be able to achieve the objectives unless it is relevant to the needs of the society. So the main objective of higher education for relevant education system is to produce the citizens who are competent to compete with the world in all spheres of life. Quality, promotion of quality education is also one of the, is one of quality of higher education always been a concern for the government. So here, in the year 1956, UGC under the statutory body act of parliament, it has given the importance for the coordination, maintenance and determination of the higher challenge in education. Now there are some problems and weaknesses in higher education. The present scenario is facing these problems. Examination reforms have been miserably showplaced, and then no provision to check excellence in universities and colleges. Curricular reforms and pedagogic reform should be coping up with the rate of achievement of knowledge. I conclude my saying with only one line. The higher education system of the 21st century should adopt the challenges of change and motivate the faculty and society to do the same. Like, in addition, it has the added responsibility to strengthen the value system in the society. It is also important to free the system from unnecessary constraints and political interference, and provided the needed academic and administration system which is accountable today. Thank you once again.
मैं सबसे पहले महमूद आलम साहब से ख्वाहिश करती हूँ कि अपना पेपर पढ़ें।
एक चीज़ और मैं वाजह कर देना चाहूँगा कि ये पेपर हम दो लोगों ने मिलकर तैयार किया है, जिसमें एक मैं हूँ और एक और मेरी साथी हैं मैडम निशात अंजुम, उन्होंने कंट्रीब्यूट किया है ये। अब मैं अपने पेपर को, जिसका टाइटल है टीचर्स रोल इन पीस एजुकेशन, उसको पेश करने की इजाज़त चाहूँगा। While peace is undoubtedly one of the most universal and significant human ideals, Raymond Panikkar, who is one of the peace educators, describes it as one of the few positive symbols having meaning for the whole of humanity. It is precisely a desire to bridge a gap between the ideal and the real. These are two different things. Normally we get confused with these two terms and use frequently on either of the places. Now, then after, there is a Hague Appeal for Peace Global Campaign for Peace Education, which tells a culture of peace will be achieved when citizens of the world understand global problems, have the skills to resolve conflicts, and struggle for justice non-violently, live by international standards of human rights and equity, appreciates cultural diversity, and respect the earth and each other. Such learning can only be achieved with systematic education for peace. Now, peace education is an elusive term. Elusive terms means you cannot easily manipulate the terms. Now, peace education has many divergent meanings for different individuals in different places. And this diversity of approach indicates the presence of a widespread desire for peace on the one hand, and the difficulty of reaching agreement on the nature of peace and the manner of creating it on the other. The absence of a universally agreed upon approach to peace is not the only reason for the very high incidence of conflict and war in different societies. The other main reason is the nature of education we provide to our children and students. Given the importance of education, we need to review our current approach and perspectives to not only our methods and content of education, but also the framework, that is, whether it is a conflict-oriented or peace-oriented, within which this education is provided. As Mahatma Gandhi observed, if we are going to bring about peace in the world, we have to begin with the children. Education of the child should be directed to the preparation of the child for responsible life in a free society, in the spirit of understanding peace, tolerance, equality of sexes, and friendship among all peoples, ethnic, national, and religious groups, and persons of indigenous origin. A number of approaches exist, both secular and religious, to help teachers cope with the prejudices, conflicts and violence in an increasingly diverse society by starting with themselves. No matter what cultural, ethnic or religious backgrounds you students come from, you encourage, praise, appreciate and reward the work of all of them as equally as possible. Positive attention to all can lead to higher achievement for all. It is worth noting that both the students and the teachers are learning cognitively and affectively from this activity. Clearly, the teacher needs certain crucial abilities and skills in order to deal effectively with conflicts between students, especially if these conflicts are intensified because of their social backgrounds. This powerful desire, this longing for universal peace, begins with us as individuals, spreads to the children and youth we teach, and though us, our students and our schools, spreads to parents, families and the community. Consistent with this, the goals of education for peace, human rights, democracy and sustainable development will be as it is. It is a large number, so it is better to omit. Now, here comes the role of the teacher in peace education. Because we are the teachers, and peace should begin with us only. Here, we should follow certain commandments. And first, as the teacher, let this peace begin with you. You are the teacher, so you must start practicing from yourself, etc. Second one is, affirm your strengths. Means, say something positive or nice to someone when an opportunity comes up. Recognize the idea they contributed. Show interest with that the learner had to say. Nod or look them into their eyes. The third one is, express feeling appropriately and encourage students to do so. Fourth is, since time is running short, so I'm not going into detail. Now fourth one, encourage respect for and acceptance of differences. Because we know that the students come from different backgrounds. So looking into their backgrounds, we must try to bring them at the same platform. Now imply more cooperative than competitive activities. Sixth, teach students how to resolve conflicts peacefully and constructively. Now let us talk about teaching learning approaches. Since there are a large number of teaching learning approaches which can be utilized for bringing the peace into the areas, we are not going to talk in detail. These approaches are, say for example, holistic education, participatory education, cooperative education, experimental education, and last but one of the most important is the humanistic approach of education. Now if we take these approaches into consideration, we are very much hopeful that a peace will prevail and the non-violence or the violence will erupt from the surface. Now here are certain teaching learning strategies through which peace can be created. One is, since here we are talking about the role of teacher, so actually these are the topics or these are the activities that are to be taken by the teacher themselves. First is the discussion, that is discussion among the students. Then another one is the peer share. Third one is the visualization or imagination of the exercises. Fourth one is the perspective teaching. Fifth one is role playing, etc., etc. Now, not to go into detail since time is running short. Now, according to one of the very important and globally known peace educator whose name is Betty Reardon, 2001, the following attributes and capabilities and capacities and skills a teacher must develop to enable oneself to be a peace messenger is, the teacher of peace is a responsible global citizen, an intentional agent of a culture of peace, a person of vision, capable of hope and the imagine of positive change. She or he understands that education should be a means towards constructive change. Another one, he or she is motivated by service and is actively involved into the community. A teacher of peace sees himself or herself as a person responsible to society. He or she is a lifelong learner, one who continues to improve one's own learning abilities and to keep abreast of the field. He or she is both a transmitter and transformer of cultures. While transmitting one's own traditional culture, the teacher also has to be critical and reflective so that he or she can also be an effective agent of social and cultural transformation. Second one is, he or she is a seeker of mutually enhancing relationship that nurtures peace and a sense of community. For example, respect for human dignity and human rights should guide teacher-student relationship and the learning processes. and he or she is gender sensitive and alert to any possibility of gender bias in self or students. He or she helps both male and female learners to form positive identification for themselves and to develop gender sensitivity and gender responsibility towards others. A teacher of peace is constructively critical. He or she offers criticism not to wound or harm, but to elicit constructive changes, and so on. Now, as a conclusive remark, I would like to say that many of the major dilemmas of our time relate to issues of peace and violent conflicts. Our vision is a more peaceful 21st century, a century that is good for all humans, Mother Earth, and the whole cosmos. We submit that building a culture of peace is among the essential goals for today and tomorrow. Human and ecological survival and well-being now and in the future depend on this. Therefore, it makes good sense for government, regional and international institutions, and all people to work together towards this vision. In turn, one of the necessary steps to build a culture of peace is to mobilize education, which is at the heart of personal and social development of a people. We need to introduce peace education in more intentional and systematic way in the formal education system and other learning environments. Let us meet the future with hope, imagination, and the willingness to forego our old thinking and ways which hinder the blossoming of a new culture that is more peaceable. Let us educate and act for peace so that our future will hold the promises that we see. To meet this end, investment in teachers and teacher education need to be made in a systematic way that appreciates the interrelationship among the political, structural, and practice aspects of the education system. Similarly, it is probably a mistake to think that diversity-sensitive pedagogy can be addressed simply as a technical issue or divorced from the political environment in which it takes place. These are complex issues. Nonetheless, the potential of investment in teachers and teacher education appears critical for social and economic development that values diversity as a necessary resource rather than a source of conflict or threat to peace and stability. Now, this is the quote of Dalai Lama on which I'm going to finish this presentation. Many of our problems are created by ourselves based on divisions due to ideology, religion, race, economic status, or other factors. The time has come for us to think on a deeper level, on a human level, and appreciate and respect our sameness as human beings. Thank you. Thanks you all.
Request ki jati hai ki wo apna paper mukhtasar taur par padhein.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. وقت بہت کم ہے اور میں بغیر کوئی وقت گنوائے بہت ہی شارٹ میں ایبسٹریکٹ صرف پڑھوں گا. جیسا کہ عنوان ہے ہمارے آج کا 21ویں صدی میں تعلیم کے چیلنجز آف ایجوکیشن ان دا 21st سینچوری. اسی کے تناظر میں میرا ٹاپک ہے ایجوکیشن وتھ اسپیشل ڈفرینس ٹو سیکولر ایجوکیشن ان انڈیا. تو سب سے پہلے ہم جو ہے سو واٹ از سیکولر ایجوکیشن اس کے بارے میں بتائیں گے. The Indian conception of secularism required that there shall be no state religion and the state shall treat all religions equally. They believed that the state moral education should be independent of religion. When I say that a state should not identify itself with any particular religion, I do not mean to say that a state should be anti-religious or irreligious. We have certainly declared India to be a secular state. But to my mind, a secular state is neither a godless state, nor an irreligious state, or nor an anti-religious state. In short, by a secular state is meant that a state shall not make any discrimination whatsoever the ground of religion or community or caste against a person, any particular form of religious faith. This means is essence that no particular religion in the state will receive any patronage or protection. So I come in some characteristic of secular education and then concluded. First of all, the moral outlook. What is the moral outlook of secular education? Development of wider vision of education, pluralistic outlook, democratic values, cultural development, synthesis of spiritual and material, and lastly, humanitarianism. I don't go to in details, so I briefly show somewhere going. Challenges of secular education in 21st century, just I concluded. In India, in which traditional institutions like religion, caste, untouchability, dowry with a special and a special child have privileging from thousands of years, the building up of a secular state is a very challenging task. Despite of the best intentions of our constitution makers and great leaders, it's difficult to establish and promote a really functional climate of secularism in India. The sum of big challenges of secular education in 21st century in India are four big challenges. First, traditional biasness and narrow outlook. In our country, today, denominational schools are allowed to function with a lot of schools, such as in mostly North India, Vaishya schools, Ahir schools, Kaist Pathshalas, Shia schools, Catholic schools, Rajput schools, etc. In these institutions, the children of respective communities or castes are admitted on a preferential basis, and also teachers of the same communities are preferred. This creates a serious difficulty for functioning of Indian education as an integrative and secular force in Indian society. So this is a dangerous thing. Second problem is too much emphasis on theoretical learning. Our educational system presents many things only in theory. That is not in be practical, only discussing in theory. A very little effort on education. Many highly educated people do not hesitate to demand big dowries. They are too fastidious about gotra in Hindu religion in North India, and as well as in South India, gotras and subcastes of Hindu in deciding in marriage. So this tradition also adopted by some educated Muslims in India also. That tradition in Hindu, if that comes in Muslim communities also, dowries and gotra and so on. They ill-treat women folk and do not show respect to the religions. The lack of tolerance and courtesy on the part of educated person towards villagers, women, poor people, minority community members, old people, etc., in buses, trains, and other public places reveals that our present public places reveals to change our value system in a desired manner. And the third thing is that, just concluding, neglect of secular and cultural celebrations. Jo manane ke liye aaj hum yahan pe maujood hai, schools, colleges and universities observe holidays on the days of important religious fairs, festivals and birthdays. The result is that the students do not get enough opportunities to understand or imbibed secular values. Today is Saturday, and also holiday in our institution. We all gathered here, very little people, in Maulana Azad Day, that is declared by Government of India National Education Day. Thank you all for coming here. अगर इस छुट्टी के दिनों में भी अगर जो सेलिब्रेशंस होते हैं उसको लोग इग्नोर कर देते हैं, जैसे आज सैटरडे था, बहुत सारे लोग छुट्टी की वजह से नहीं आए, तो इन चीज़ों को ये जानते हैं कि हम कौमी तालीमी दिन है, मौलाना आज़ाद की कितनी अहमियत है इस एजुकेशन के ताल्लुक से, तो इन चीज़ों को स्कूल लेवल पे भी, कॉलेज लेवल पे भी और हायर इदारे में भी तमाम जगह जो है सो इग्नोर कर दिया जाता है। जैसे इतवार का दिन है, अगर उस दिन किसी का बड़ा दिन है तो उसको नहीं मनाते हैं लोग। ये एक गैदर होने का एक मौका मिलता है उस दिन हम सबों को, वो भी मौका हमसे जाता रहता है। दैट इज वेरी थिंकेबल पॉइंट। एंड फोर्थ एंड लास्ट पॉइंट इज माय पेपर, नेग्लेक्ट ऑफ ग्रुप एक्टिविटीज। एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस डू नॉट इनकरेज ग्रुप एक्टिविटीज। ग्रुप एक्टिविटीज एंड ग्रुप मेथड ऑफ टीचिंग एंड लर्निंग आर नेग्लेक्टेड। दिस इज अ सीरियस चैलेंज इन द प्रमोशन ऑफ सेकुलर एंड वैल्यूज ऑफ एजुकेशन। So I just concluded, there is a need for appropriate educational action to meet these challenges. So I think and think for it. Thank you very much.
Ab main Aftab se request karti hoon ki wo Shakira Parveen ka paper padhe.
Assalamu alaikum to everyone present here. जैसा कि मोहतरमा मैडम साहिबा इसे आप लोग से वाकिफ करा दिए हैं कि मैं किस हैसियत से यहाँ पर हाजिर हूँ, और मैं मोहतरमा साकरा परवीन साहिबा का पेपर पढ़ने जा रहा हूँ जो इस चैलेंज ऑफ एजुकेशन इन द 21st सेंचुरी के ताल्लुक से लिखे हैं। तो आप लोग मोहतरमा साकरा परवीन की तहरीर की हुई ये छोटी सी कहानी सुनिए, आफ्ताब आलम की जबानी। रोल ऑफ टीचर एजुकेटर्स इन द प्रेजेंट सिनेरियो। दिस पेपर इज इंटेंडेड टू शो द डिफरेंट रोल्स ए टीचर एजुकेटर हैज़ टू प्ले टुडे इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी एज। There was a time when the teacher was known as epitome of all virtues. The teacher's word was regarded as the word of God. There is a question always insulting in my mind that can we teacher educators shape our teacher trainees as teachers of yesteryears? We have heard a lot about the 21st century learners, but what about the 21st century teacher educators? We know that teacher educators are student-centric, holistic. They are teaching about how to teach as much as teaching about the content or subject area. We know that must be 21st century learners as well, but teacher educators should be more than this. In today's ICTs, it can be very difficult to get a grip on the evolving roles of teacher educators. The 21st century, teacher educators are supposed to play the roles of enthusiastic learners, a good communicators, a collaborator, a technician, a mentor, a researcher, a vision, a leader, a model for others, a director, a planner, a facilitator, an evaluator, and also a risk taker. To adapt a world of new resources to support traditional methods such as incorporation of software programs in the classroom. The teacher educators' part in the process of training and instruction, like the art of the gardener under whose care a thousand trees blossom and grow. He or she contributes nothing to their actual growth. The potential of growth lies in the trees themselves. He or she plants and waters. मैं कंक्लूड करना चाहूँगा वक्त की लिहाज से। थैंक यू इट्स ओके। टीचर एजुकेटर्स मिशन इज नॉट मेयरली टू टीच द टीचर ट्रेनीज फॉर ए पार्टी फाइनेंशियल कंसिडरेशन बट टू फॉर्म ह्यूमन कैरेक्टर। द वर्ल्ड टुडे हैज मेनी प्रोफेशनल्स एंड टेक्नोक्रेट्स। व्हाट इट lacks is the good human beings. The teacher educator is the molder of human destinies. If a teacher educator in his lifetime influence a few or even a single life, he would be able to achieve his mission. That's it from the presentation.
Jo Shakira Parveen ka paper pad rahe the, main ab Mohtarma Najma Sahib Najma Begum Sahiba se darkhast karti hu ki wo अपने पेपर को पढ़ें।
द चिल्ड्रंस विद डिजेबिलिटीज। नाउ ओनली दैट इज वॉज द स्कोप ऑफ द एक्सेप्शनल एजुकेशन विद डिजेबिलिटीज आर विद गिफ्टेड चिल्ड्रेन आर स्लो लर्नर्स फिजिकली हैंडीकैप एवरीथिंग बट नॉट ऑल नीड्स ऑल फैसिलिटीज। चिल्ड्रेन फ्रॉम 0 to 14 ईयर्स दे मस्ट हैव एटलीस्ट बेसिक एजुकेशन द एजुकेशन विच इज नीडेड फॉर देम टू लर्न टू हैव बेसिक नेसेसिटीज Because of that one, inclusive education has become a strategy now to include as a process to achieve education for all. There are many agencies like Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, UE, Minimum Level of Learning, every by some other name, they are working together to form an education for all. That is a right of a child. Now, how to include education for all? That is the problem. That is a challenge. The normal teacher will say, I don't have a time to teach the slow learners. I can't have a time to teach with the students with difficulties. How to teach them? What is the role of a teacher now? Why the inclusive, how to achieve the target of inclusiveness? Now, if any school fails, the result is less. We blame either the student or the school. We blame the student. The students have very low IQ, no motivation, socio-economic status is very less, curriculum is not there to have very much facilities for that one. Or we blame the schools, there doesn't have any teacher proper learning, teacher-student ratio is very high over here, teachers are unable to make a better arrangement with the students. These are the other many reasons are there. But how to cope up with these things? There are many technologies coming over here. We are thinking that computer can solve all the problems. But schools, some schools, they are teaching only the computers, how to operate the computers. But they are not teaching how to learn with computers. The computer learns how to learn the students with computers, the content of the subject. How to a slow learner can learn the subject? How a slow learner problems with any difficulties can achieve his basic education? How can he live in the world? These are the problems to be faced. Now, how did this one? Recently, our union minister, Kapil Sibal, have introduced a portal, that one computer for every student. Within 2200, we can have a computer to learn internet services. And students can have only 50% of that one. So now the technologies are there, but how to use the technology? The e-classrooms are there, and everything, every facility is there, but the teacher is not ready to use in the classroom. The old age methods of teaching and learning, lecturing method, and everything is going on. But how to accommodate the inclusive students? How to accommodate the disadvantaged students into the classroom? How to reach the tribal students? How to reach the remote places students? How to reach the girl students who are very far and we are unable to reach the school? To solve this problem, there are many aspects they have taken out. Satellite-based education, EduSat education, radio programs, television programs, distance education, there are many ways so that each and every child can have their education. The open school system has come up for that one. If any child is unable to come to the regular formal school, they can come from open school system. They can have their end. If any child fails to learn all the subjects, in a school we make a rigid curriculum that every child should learn all the 5-6 subjects. But if a child doesn't understand mathematics, if a child doesn't understand language, English, if he fails, then we make a target. You can't proceed further. There are policies which are stopping them to learn other further studies. But to cut down that one, the inclusive education has a strategy. Let the child learn with its own way. Make him a self-determination. Develop an assessment which can develop a self-determination in the child. And he can achieve his success in the future. And he can make his livelihood. So education should not be related to only to the schooling. The education should make his basic life skills and able to learn, live in a society. And social tolerance should be there. We say, जो तो पागल है हमारे साथ कहाँ से पढ़ेगा वो जरा दिमागी तौर से कमजोर है हमारे साथ नहीं बैठ सकेगा Have a social tolerance. Make a difference learning with the disabled children. Know their problems and try to solve the problems of you and your friends inside. And the friendship makes a basic necessity that helps your children to learn more. And self-confidence and self-determination is necessary to overcome as inclusive as a strategy. Thank you.
मैं अब अपने आखिरी प्रेजेंटर मिस्टर मुशाहे से दरख्वास्त करती हूँ मुझे मालूम है कि वो बहुत मुख्तसर ही पढ़ने वाले हैं
मेरे मकाले का उन्वान है रिलेवेंस ऑफ मौलाना आजाद्स एजुकेशनल थॉट इन 21st सेंचुरी यानी कि 21वीं सदी में मौलाना आजाद के तालीमी अफकार की अहमियत عزیزوں وقت ہو چلا ہے اوپن ایئر تھیٹر کا پروگرام بھی ہمارا انتظار کر رہا ہے اس طریقے سے میں اپنی بات کو بالکل مختصر سے مختصر طور پر کہنا چاہوں گا یعنی کہ آج سے تقریباً 60 تا 65 سال پہلے مولانا آزاد جب بحیثیت وزیر تعلیم تھے اور تقریباً وہ 10 تا 11 سال تک اس جلیل عہدے پر فائز رہے اس وقت میں انہوں نے تعلیم کے سلسلے میں کیا کیا اور کیا کہا اس کو ہم آج یعنی کہ 21ویں صدی یا موجودہ دور میں اس کی کیا اہمیت ہے یا ریلیونس ہے اس کو ہم دیکھنے کی کوشش کریں گے اس کو میں صرف اور صرف جو ہے پوائنٹ کی صورت میں میں آپ کے سامنے پیش کرنے کی کوشش کروں گا مولانا آزاد سب سے پہلے جس بات پر متمنی تھے اور وہ سوچتے تھے وہ تھا ہمارا نیشنل انٹیگریشن یعنی کہ قومی یکجہتی اب جو ہے قومی یکجہتی آزادی سے پہلے آزادی کے وقت اور آج بھی ہم اس کا رونا روتے ہیں ہم سب کو معلوم ہے کہ قومی یکجہتی کیوں ضروری ہے اس میں حائل کون کون سی رکاوٹیں ہیں بہرکیف آج کے دور میں بھی ہم قومی یکجہتی کی بات کر رہے ہیں یعنی کہ اب تک ہمارا ملک قومی یکجہتی کے مقاصد کو حاصل نہیں کر سکا ہے اس طریقے سے ہم یہ کہہ سکتے ہیں کہ مولانا آزاد نے آج سے جو 65 سال قبل جو بات کہی آج بھی اس کی ضرورت ہے نیکسٹ جو بات جو انہوں نے جو کہی سائنس اور ٹیکنیکل تعلیم کے فروغ میں یہ ہم جو ہے بخوبی واقف ہیں کہ انہوں نے آئی آئی ٹی کھڑک پور کا سب سے پہلے قیام کیا اور وہ یہ چاہتے تھے کہ ہمارے ملک میں سائنس اور ٹیکنالوجی کی تعلیم اس حد تک فروغ پائے کہ ہمارے ملک کے بچے پڑھنے کے ساتھ ساتھ باہر کے بچے بھی ہمارے ملک میں آئیں اور ٹیکنیکل اور فنی تعلیم کو حاصل کریں اس کی آج بھی اتنی ہی اہمیت ہے اس کے بعد مولانا سب سے زیادہ فکر مند تھے یہ مشرق اور مغرب کے سوچ میں جو خلا تھی اس کے بارے میں اور وہ یہ چاہتے تھے کہ مشرق اور مغرب کے جو سوچ میں اور فکر میں جو خلا ہے اس کو پر کر دیا جائے اس کو اس گیپ کو فل کر دیا جائے تبھی ہم ترقی کی راہ پر گامزن ہو سکتے ہیں اس کی ریلیونس آج بھی ہے اس کے بعد مولانا ہمارے ہندوستانی کلچر کے تحفظ کی بھی بات کرتے تھے کنزرویشن آف آور رچ کلچرل ہیریٹیج کیونکہ کسی بھی سماج کی کسی بھی ملک کی کسی بھی قوم کی شناخت اس کی اپنی تہذیبی و ثقافتی اور تمدن جو ہے ہوا کرتی تھی اس لیے مولانا آزاد ہمیشہ یہ کہتے تھے کہ اپنے تہذیب و تمدن اور کلچر کا تحفظ کیجیے آج بھی اس کی اہمیت اتنی ہی ہے جتنی کہ آج سے تقریباً 60 اور 65 سال قبل تھی مولانا آزاد بالغوں کی تعلیم میں اسا چاہتے تھے یعنی کہ ایڈلٹ ایجوکیشن اور انہوں نے ہی اس کا نام چینج کر کے سوشل ایجوکیشن کا نام رکھا یعنی کہ ہمارے ملک میں 18 سے اوپر کے عمر کے جو نوجوان ہیں کسی بھی وجہ سے اگر تعلیم حاصل نہیں کر سکے ہوں یا ترک تعلیم ہو گئی ہو تو وہ اپنی زندگی میں کامیابی و کامرانی حاصل کرنے کے لیے یا اپنے تعلیم کو جاری و ساری رکھنے کے لیے وہ اپنے تعلیم کو ہمیشہ جاری رکھیں اس کے لیے تمام مختلف قسم کے تعلیمی پروگرام آج بھی ہمارے ملک میں شروع ہو رہے ہیں اس طریقے سے یہ کہا جا سکتا ہے کہ مولانا آزاد نے جو آج سے 60 تا 65 سال قبل جو بات کہی آج بھی اس کی اتنی ہی اہمیت ہے اس کے بعد مولانا خواتین کی تعلیم پر خصوصی توجہ دی اور یعنی کہ 20ویں صدی کے اخیر میں ان کے خواب کی شرمندہ تعبیر کی شکل میں یہ مولانا آزاد نیشنل اردو یونیورسٹی کا قیام ہوا اور اس کے جو مقاصد ہیں جو اہم جو مقاصد ہیں اس میں ایک مقصد ہے خواتین کی تعلیم پر خصوصی توجہ. اس طریقے سے ہم یہ کہہ سکتے ہیں کہ ان کی سوچ جو اس وقت تھی آج بھی اس کی اتنی ہی اہمیت ہے. فنون لطیفہ کی ترقی یعنی کہ فائن آرٹس, اس سے زندگی کو جلا ملتی ہے. اس کے بعد اساتذہ کی فلاح و بہبود. مولانا آزاد نے اپنے آخری خطبے میں ٹیچرز کو خطاب کرتے ہوئے کہا تھا کہ ہمارے تعلیمی نظام کا جو محور ہے وہ ہمارے اساتذہ ہیں, اور انہوں نے حکومت کو یہ آگاہ کیا تھا کہ ہمارے ملک کے اساتذہ کی جو سماجی اور معاشی صورتحال ہے اس کو بہتر بنایا جائے, کیونکہ ہمارے تعلیم کا پورا دار و مدار انہی پر منحصر ہے, جس کی اہمیت آج بھی اتنی ہی ہے. اور آخر میں نوجوانوں کے متوازن شخصیت کی نشو نما. یہ تعلیم کا الٹیمیٹ مقصد ہے کہ ہماری شخصیت کا متوازن نشو نما ہو, یعنی کہ ہمارے شخصیت کا کوئی بھی پہلو یا کوئی بھی شمع چھوٹ نہ جائے اور ہم ایک بہتر شہری, جسمانی طور پر, جذباتی طور پر, سماجی طور پر, اخلاقی طور پر ایک بہترین انسان جو ہے بننے کی کوشش کریں. اس طریقے سے ہم یہ کہہ سکتے ہیں کہ مولانا آزاد کے تعلیمی افکار کی آج یعنی کہ 21ویں صدی میں اتنی ہی اہمیت ہے جتنی کہ آج سے تقریباً 65 سال قبل تھی. اسی بات کے ساتھ میں اپنی بات کو ختم کرتا ہوں. شکریہ, بہت بہت شکریہ.